Hey, welcome everyone to our virtual open mic collaboration from Wexford Bohemian and the Waxed Lemon. So I'm going to go through the rundown quickly because I've had a few emails and I've been kind of telling the same thing to everybody. So for starters, we're going to have the contributors and the editors of both publications reading. And we have about 20 readers. So we'll play it by ear. If you want to read one piece, if you want to read two, three, maybe short pieces, whichever you prefer. If people could mute their microphones, I don't want to have to do that just while people are reading, just so we don't have any feedback or any interruptions at all. And after the contributors are finished reading, we'll have an open mic for anyone who's not part of either magazine and wants to maybe say a little piece, if we have time, bear in mind. But I don't think we'll be too stuck for time, but there are a lot of us here. So if you would like to read afterwards, just throw your name into the old chat there, if you can, and I'll call on you afterwards. I just wanted to make a few announcements. I'd like to thank Lime Square Poets for the kind of idea. That's so ironic because one of the runners of Lime Square Poets has just joined. Lime Square Poets is it was established between Limerick and Cork, but it was established online over lockdown. And it's something I came across kind of late last year, and it inspired me massively because you have this Zoom, just like we are, two women from Ireland running it, and you've readers from all over the world, and just the way they control it, the way they organize it, it's really admirable, and it's so fun. It's just like an open mic in real life. I don't know how they're capable of doing it, but it's very enjoyable. So I'd like to thank them, and at the start of all of their events they have a little, or just to note that maybe one of their contributors has published the book or whatnot. So for us, we have loads of big news here in Wexford, and I'm delighted that this is our last final goodbye to Wexford Literary Festival 2022, and it's a great closing off event. Our contributor of the Wexford Bohemian, John Cooney, has just launched his book, Three L's in the Alphabet, and it's available to purchase on his website, johncooneypoetry.com. I got lots of compliments about John's poem that was featured in the Bohemian, so I'll definitely make sure to paste that website into the chat. And of course, congratulations to Red Books on their expansion. Red Books 2.0, as we refer to it now. And congrats to our sister publication, Wexford Women Writing Undercover, who had their launch yesterday. We're exceptionally proud of you. And it was a beautiful launch, although I couldn't stay for the whole thing. So I'll call on each of the contributors, and hopefully they're there. If they're not there, or they're not ready to read yet, we'll come back to them. But we're going to open up with some music from Derek Flynn. And if you'd like to give a brief introduction about yourself, feel free to do so.
Thanks, Alana, and hello, everybody. I'll just introduce, it's myself and Joanne McCarthy. Joanne is here with us as well, and we are the editors of the Wax Lemon, which is based, it's a literary journal that's based in Waterford. I know we have some people here tonight who are going to read the pieces that they've had published in our fourth issue, which is going to be launched next Friday in Waterford in the Book Centre, and then it will go on sale. It's on sale in the Book Centre and a few other outlets as well, but also from, it'll be on sale. Hello?
Derek, I've just muted everyone just in case there's any feedback there. If you just unmute yourself, it should work and there shouldn't be that kind of intrusive noise. Try it there now.
Yeah, there we go. Perfect. I think
I'm a
confused. Could everyone, yeah, there we go. I It's literally just one laptop or phone or something feeding back. That's all it is. Okay. So yeah, we'll be our issue 4 will be on sale on thewaxlemon.com and from the Book Centre in Waterford and a few other outlets as well. And yeah, I think that's it. Unless Joanne, did you want to add anything? Oh, we had to unmute Joanne as well there, sorry.
Thanks, Lana. Derek, I don't like this function that you have where you can mute me at your head. I like this power balance.
Yeah, I'm going to get Lana to show me how to do that now.
No, thanks, Lana, for organising this and for inviting us, and it's great to be here. And I'm really looking forward to hearing everybody read. And yes, Waxlemon is going to be launched next week. We're very excited about issue 4. So thank you to everybody who sent us their work, and we're really looking forward to hearing it. Thank you.
Okay, so I'll kick off with a little bit of music and then I'll let Alana get into our contributors. And this is, we'll kick off with a little bit of Leonard Cohen. This is Famous Blue Raincoat. It's 4 in the morning, the end of December. I'm writing you now just to see if you're better. New York is cold, but I like where I'm living. There's music on Clinton Street all through the evening. I hear that you're building your little house deep in the desert. You're living for nothing now. I hope you're keeping some kind of record. Yes, and Jane came by with a lock of your hair. She said that you gave it to her night that you planned to go clear. Did you ever go clear? Oh, the last time we saw you, you looked so much older. Your famous blue raincoat was torn at the shoulder. You've been to the station to meet every train, and you came home alone without Lily Marlene. And you treated my woman to a piece of your life. And when she came back, she was nobody's wife. Well, I see you there with a rose in your teeth. One more thin gypsy thief. I see James awake. She sends her regards. Oh, what can I tell you? My brother, my killer. What can I possibly say? I guess that I miss you. I guess I forgive you. Glad that you stood in my way. And if you ever come by here, for Jane or for me, well, your enemy is sleeping and your woman is free. Yes, and thanks for the trouble you took from her eyes. I thought that it was there for good, so I never tried. And Jane came by with a lock of your hair. She said that you gave it to her the night that you planned to go clear. Sincerely, Al Cohen. Thanks, guys. I'll hand it over to Alana.
Wow, what a treat, Derek. That's incredible. I love a bit of Cohen. That was beautiful. Thank you so much. Wasn't expecting that now for a Zoom again a Sunday. But I'm going to call on our first reader. I thought we'd open big. Alston, are you ready? I think you need to unmute.
Hi. Alana, thanks so much for putting this on, and thank you so much for publishing my story. Thanks, Derek and Joanne. This is terrific, from many, many thousands of miles away. the story that is in Wexford Bohemian is called Up in Sky, Down in Dirt. It's very short. Adeline and I met at Serena's birthday party in Maynooth, one part rave, two part salon, a sketchy combo I quite expected. Serena, whom I had known since uni, was from her teens bipolar with a rapid cycling asterisk meaning exactly what it means. It's like disguising yourself from yourself, she once offered. We were never lovers. I had long denied the impulse, afraid the re-psych, as she called it, might rudely kick in somewhere along the arc. Who's ready for that? So we were friends, to the degree Adeline was a setup, one that led Adeline and me to become as one about 6 minutes after leaving Serena's party and finding opportunity in a patch of moonlit side garden. It was something Adeline would observe some weeks later. Gripping dwarf ryegrass and dirt far surpasses gripping Egyptian cotton. Adeline had forgotten her purse, so I went back into the house. You've grass stains on your knees, Christopher, Serena observed as she handed me Adeline's magenta purse. Well, I suppose I do. I actually saw you. You did? Yes, I was on the upstairs toilet. You know, the one with the tiny gable window. Well, it just happened, you know. I thought you and Adeline might get on, but not quite so urgently. Well, the Napo Castle and I, thank you, I said with genuine warmth. I saw the whole thing. I mean, I could have stepped away from the window, but it was all so comfortable. Comfortable? Yes, having a wee some 40 feet into the sky, gazing down. I grasped that, I said. It's all about fluids, isn't it? She said. Down in the dirt, up in the sky. You ask me where the border is between the manic and the depressive. That's just it, you see. There is no border, not even a smidgen of one. We kissed hard, then I left, seeing Adeline to her car and driving away on my own. The end.
Well done, Alison. A great piece that I was honored to read at our issue 3 launch on the 10th of June. Are you enjoying your reading of Wexford Bohemian all those miles away?
Very much so. Very much so. And I have to compliment Red Books. They did just a marvelous job of producing this. It's a really beautiful book physically, and the layout is so nice, and I love the arrangements. They're very unexpected transitions. Rich mix.
Brilliant. I'm delighted to hear it. My next reader is Mr. Chris Black. Are you there, Chris?
Yep. Can you hear me?
I can hear you perfectly, Machara. Are you ready?
Yeah, sure. No bother. No Escape from the book. No Escape. It shows no mercy, the raging sea carries that threat eternally. Its calmness can so deceive. How quick it takes life is beyond belief. It matters not how careful you are. The sea is the master. Life it will scar. The sea in its cruelest form, dreadful acts will perform. It shows no mercy, the raging sea carries that threat eternally. They head off, outwardly showing no fear. Fishermen brave are they, enjoying the freedom of the sea, tasting its salty spray. Returning later with their catch, the sea erupts, waves they lash. It matters not how careful you are, the sea is the master. Life it will scar. Waves crashing against the rocks, lives lost, boat upturned, the sea mocks. It shows no mercy, the raging sea carries that threat eternally. Thank you, and congratulations again to Alana and Red Books, and to the rest of the contributors. Enjoy reading the book, and we'll continue to enjoy reading the book. And good luck for this evening, and to the Waterford Connection. Good to have you here amongst the yellow bellies.
Thanks so much, Chris. That was beautiful reading for a beautiful poem.
Thanks, Alana.
For anyone that joined late, we're having an open mic afterwards for anyone who isn't included in either, or isn't a contributor rather, in either of the books that would like to take part. So that's two great readers so far, if I do say so myself. I'm going to pass it on to Derek to introduce the next reader.
Here we go. okay, so the first of, I think we have five readers from the Waxed Lemon issue 4, and the first person we're going to have, I apologize in advance because I'm possibly going to mispronounce your name, and I see you're smiling already. You know it's coming. Suhatia Menon. Just hold on one sec till Alana unmutes you there.
Cool, thank you so much. Sue's fine. Sue, that's cool, but it's Sujata.
Sujata, okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really delighted to be here. So I thought I'd read two poems. The first one is the one you're publishing. So it's called Banana Bread. What do I worship to receive this blessing in my hands, with fingers in so many unholy places? I once stroked a bird until my last breath, buried her in omens falling from unfiltered prayers. Reborn in the filth of the past, milk, flowers and honey in my palms, I cannot bring it to my lips for fear of drowning in this leaf floating in my fists. Buoyant with turmeric and swollen grains, camphor, cooked fruit and sandalwood paste, all sprinkled with cholera from the Ganga. What do I worship to receive this blessing in my hands, baking and aching for some wild idol? And then my second poem is from my new book, which was written during a residency on the east side of Scotland. It's called Vultures on Cromarty Bay. There is a crow that struts like Sir Jagger, carries a bead of cake in its beak it found on the floor of Slaughterhouse Cafe. Later, after parading its secret like we do with Indian gold, it will place its moment of fortune beside a pair of cracked glass eyes, a platinum tooth, a red ruby bobble, and 177 other things that speak of a home made from the ruins of others. I think about the wedding bangles locked along with my semi-precious eggs in a safe, safe in the deep belly of the homeland, waiting their turn to be cleaved, to be taken by a smacked black foot. Thank you.
Beautiful reading, Sue. That was lovely. Two beautiful poems. For anyone that's reading upcoming, feel free to say a few words about yourself, introduce yourself to everyone. Most of us are strangers anyway. Our next reader is the fantastic Mary O'Brien. Mary, are you there? Probably have to unmute you, sorry, Mary.
Hello?
Yeah, perfect.
You got me?
Yeah.
Thanks very much, Elena, and thanks very much to all the organisers and to all those involved in the Wexford Bohemian, in which I was published there the last time round. The poem I'll read the one that's in the last issue there of the Bohemian, and over the last few years, I've been writing in Irish as well as in English, just for torture, I suppose, really, but because of an interest in the languages as well, I suppose. And in Wexford, we have an interesting mixture of languages because we have the remnants of the Irish and we have the remnants of the Norse, of course. And then in South Wexford, there's particularly the remnants of the Anglo-Normans, where the Yola language, Yolda, was spoken up until some years ago. So there's an interesting mixture if you have any interest in words and where they come from. So in this poem here, it's just a memory really of going into neighbours at home years ago where I was reared in North Wexford. And I suppose hearing the different Hiberno English, I suppose you would call it. So just some of the words, if you don't understand all the words in the poem, well, that's quite okay, because that was the point of the thing, really, I suppose, just to show that we all are individuals in the different parts of the country. So just a few, there's a note on the bottom of the poem, and one of the words there that appears in the poem is the word grummock, which you might have heard, and that comes from the Irish gruama. And there's another one here, a figeri, to take a figeri, which would be a mood or a whim, and that actually comes from the English dialect, vagary, from the Latin. Now, I'm no scholar, but I do look up books, so that's how I come to this knowledge, you know. So there's another one here called prate, and I'm sure maybe everybody has heard about, if you were somebody was prating, and if you use the word prate, you're actually using middle low German, in case you didn't know. And then there's another one which here I thought I'd find interesting is dishables, a word which I would have heard used a lot at home. If you were in your dishables, you would be in your old clothes or your kind of second, kind of type clothes. Like you wouldn't go to mass now in your dishables, really. And that comes from, it's an English dialect from the French, en déshabille. So it's interesting to realize that we were actually speaking some French, at home. So the name of the poem is Word Hoard. And there's, if I can see it here now, there's an epigraph at the beginning from Seamus Heaney, from his poem, Clear in Clearances. And where he talks about going home to his mother and speaking in the kind of the local dialect that he was reared with. And so the quote is, "So I governed my tongue in front of her, a genuinely well-adjusted, adequate betrayal of what I knew better. So I'll read it then. Cheer up, you might be told. Don't look so grummock. Or is there something ails you this evening, Alana? Had a bazzy with that other girl. A bit of a gleeguin, I'd say. The father was a fancy meg, and often angish, I hear. And great goss are under the mother. I remember the day she stepped in a bed of pismires when we were childer, turned a dunducketty grey and fainted, gave us all a right fright. Himself is not a thin, took a figuery to go out after more brosna before the dark sets in. He went off at a great souther, wouldn't put on his heavy coat and him with a bit of a crock. No doubt he'll run into that Andy, a great man to prate, and they'll be beyant there serenading at great length, and sorry the one of them will think to keep an eye on the time. He'll come home then, killed with the druth, looking tay. I'll get you to help me lift this up on the thaliog to make more room for the Ballygarrett vizards when they come, and to get this firm over for Nance the dresser. Make room for a right stave, a good randy boo. Don't scrub yourself there with that nail on the corner. Good child, you're no slinge. I'll have to get out now of these dishabills, not to look like a streel. Some of the vizards will be musicianers, and you can play your French fiddle along with them when they come. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you, Mary. I'm going to scrawb. I recognise there, may I say, in Waterford, we'd say you got a scrawb off something, and a few other ones as well. They're very good. So I'm going to introduce the next reader from the latest issue of the Wax Lemon. Just before I do, I forgot to mention just a bit about Sue when I introduced her there. Sue is a poet and a musician based in the UK, an editor of Crostio Poetry Journal, and she's been published internationally, and her songwriting, singing, have been broadcast on radio, TV, and featured in magazines such as Rolling Stone. So for the next virtual open mic, we'll have to reel you in for some singing. And our next reader is Sarah Barr. Sarah lives in Dorset, where she writes poetry and fiction, often on psychological, social, and environmental subjects. And her poetry pamphlet, January, was published by Maytree Press, and her short story collection, Night Zoo, was published by Lendl Press. Hello, Sarah.
Hello. Thank you very, very much for including me. It's lovely to be here. It's great. Thank you. I'm going to read the flash fiction story that you kindly published in the Wax Lemon. The shirt. In the morning, you wake up wearing a tattered denim shirt, and for a few moments, all is well. Just another lockdown day, searching for a job, quarrelling remotely with your sister, and buffing up possessions to sell. Gulls fly past in the bright sky. A baby chatters in the room below. Then you remember. You don't want to get up, but you do. You brew tea, spread margarine on sliced bread, and sob. At midday, you force yourself out past the pub and onto the salt, windy pebble beach. Your sneakers have thin soles. Stones dig into your feet. You don't go into the pub. You remember 3 months ago. It was his birthday and he didn't want to spend it with you. He thanked you for the plaid shirt, but wouldn't try it on. He said he liked it, but you could see he didn't. You said, when can we be a real couple? Spend the day together. When can I meet your mum? He said, she thinks badly of you, living in a hostel, your brother locked up. You said, for his own safety. You wanted him to spend the day with you. You knew he loved you. He went into the pub where you weren't welcome. He stayed for hours with his drinking buddies. You walked along the beach searching for ammonites. You saw him and his fishing mate push the wooden boat down the slipway and into the sea. You ran from the far end of the beach shouting, but he wouldn't stop. It was his birthday, and he could do what he wanted. They had their fishing gear on board. It was sunny weather. No need for life jackets. He said he'd bring you mackerel for tea. You remember, it was late in the day. You were angry and slapped him. You loved him too much. He said, see, this is why we aren't a couple. To placate you, he took the new shirt out of the bag, put it on, tossed the old one into the water. You hated him for wearing what had cost so much and would now be ripped and stink of fish. When the boat didn't come back, you knew you'd lost everything. They said you'd driven him to it with your fighting. The funeral was a private lockdown affair they didn't invite you to. It's night now, and you wrap yourself in the shirt the colour of sea and sky. Try to blot out the baby's screams. Try to sleep as gulls fling themselves against the window. Thank you. I thought it goes rather well with Chris's poem that he read earlier about the sea. So I think that fits well together.
Definitely. That's beautiful, Sarah. And actually, I don't know if it was the same for the Wax Lemon, but I found an abundance of submissions were based on the theme of water and sea. Maybe that's because we're beside the sea, I'm not sure, but it's great to see the sea. Our next reader is from the Wexford Bohemian. Thank you so much, Sarah. Marichelle, are you ready to read?
Hiya.
Hi, Marichelle.
Thanks so much for having me. It's such a pleasure to be able to be on the third issue already and just hopefully keep them going, even if I'm no longer in Wexford, I'm not that far. So I'm just going to read the one that's in the final issue. What time is love? 10 past 10, that is what she would have said if she had been looking the same direction I was. The little pocket watch would hang, protected behind a glass, framed with fake gold paint. Below, there was a small description about the story behind it, but that at the moment did not matter. The walls were green halfway up and covered in pattern like wood halfway down. The pub was brighter than the ones I used to sit in alone. The time I was with her in an illuminated place where I could confusingly see her face, shades and shadows playing tricks on the side of her nose and below her eyes, making her look slimmer and more tired than she actually was. The pocket watch was accompanied by two portraits of people on either side. Black and white faces staring at the emptiness of the pub, brought back to life with colorful matching flower patterns on top of a white background before being caged in a rustic, tacky, fake gold frame. I had never seen her like this before. By this, I mean her state of mind. Her behavior was rather awkward. She was not drunk, but she was tipsy. It was easy to tell by the way she moved and how she was enchanted by the small yellow flame, deteriorating away the flat white melting candle. Her fingers brushed the flame the same way a lover would carefully play with the rebel mane of their partner. She pressed her fingers against the candle, at the point where the wax was still solid enough to stand, but not to the extra pressure of a stranger invading its privacy. She wasn't looking at me. She wasn't looking at her surroundings either. Nothing was distracting her. She was lost in that black hole where we all have been. The spiral where you keep telling yourself you are fully aware of what you're doing, yet you're not conscious enough to be present in the tangible reality we all belong. What time is love? 10 past 10. That is what she would have said if she had been looking the same direction I was. It was a big challenge, but we decided to go for it. A flat, her and me, just me and her. A single room to sleep in. A single kitchen to cook in, a single living room to share time with. I cannot explain, and I never will, but it was what I would have never dreamt of. The candles were always burning by 8:30, on the spot, the same way bells would ring to announce the unfortunate death of some stranger we would never grieve for. She always liked to look at them, but she was never brave enough to light them. Her worry was always the same, us walking past too fast. Pieces of paper, books, or curtains lying around too close to the burning flame. But it made it like home. It made her neck taste sweeter as I shamelessly took over her own private space, while drinking a cup of tea before bed. The warm glow of the fire made her skin look toasted and her eyes darker. The light emphasized her face, the beauty of the person I was spending every day of my life, like I had never lived it before. What time is love? 10 past 10. That is what she would have said if she had been looking the same direction I was. But she said, without a smile on her face, that it was time to go away, together, to a place no one has ever come back from. The pocket watch said it was 10 past 10, hanging on the green wall of the pub, trapped in the gold rectangular box and overprotected with glass. At home, the candles were lighted at 8:30, the perfect time for dinner where it was not too late for me or too early for her. The time the place burned down was not 9 or 10, it was in between, where nothing ever happened, where our lives were about to collide to create the next big bang. She knew, she had always been aware that at some point it would all come down to that. Another evening with a brand new set of candles, because the old ones had just become a pile of wax at the bottom of the plate, with melted tears hanging over the edges. The flame burning higher than it used to, her books and my notes piling up on the corner of the table that somehow managed to turn into a shelf. The blazing fire spreading fast, from each furniture item to the window, to the dusty carpet that we never managed to keep decently clean. Us holding hands, myself stealing another sweet kiss from her neck, right below the earlobe where she used to hide all her passion and desire. Our hands tangling as we let the fire bring the house down with both of us in it, letting what we were supposed to call love kill us by filling our lungs with fake promises, lies, and black smoke from the cigars I never used to light. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much for that. That was gorgeous. I'm going to go to Miriam O'Neill now. Miriam's work has appeared in Galway Review, Lily Poetry Review, North Dakota Quarterly, and elsewhere. She has 3 collections of poetry, the more recent being The Half-Said Things. She's from Plymouth, Massachusetts. She believes in self-autonomy and compassion. Hello, Miriam.
Hello. Am I?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, good, good. I can't see me, so I don't know. Let me see if I, there I, well, I'm there somewhere. Okay. Thank you, Wax Lemon, for taking my poem, Crabtree Circle, 1973, which I'll read for you, and it's a narrative lyric. It's based on a true story told to me. And in this time of issues of autonomy, it feels more important to read it. Crabtree Circle, 1973. In mid-afternoon, she reaches into the dark of her mailbox and voila, her mother's word, a bill she'll leave beside her husband's ashtray. He'll pay for the electricity. Next week, the phone she never answers will come due. Each check printed with her married name, a flag of surrender she used to wish her mother had waved all those years ago. That war against ordinary life ended. At night, she pulls down every shade, but leaves the nightlight on in the bathroom. Oh, nightlight. Oh, tiles shining in that glow, a pink as pale as morning skies over the prairie. Just the slash she'd see as she lay beside her brother in the trunk of the old Chevelle, its hood ajar for air. Their mother asleep behind the wheel, a loaded pistol under her seat. Locusts still cheer in dreams here on Crabtree Circle, where the retired neighbor's beagle hurls against his chain link kennel with sad brown eyes. His owner's mouth with its cheroot clamped in one corner reminds me of her mother's lips pinched around a cigarette, one after another fished from her purse all day while driving, all day the cul-de-sacs quiet, except Wednesdays when the trash collectors clank along the curb, each barrel full, a testament to life lived in one place. And at 5 o'clock, the driveways fill with cars of Crabtree's minions returning, heroes of the harrows of regular employment, her Joe among them. He's kind. Each day unwinds now, like those roads between cornfields with no end, the sky too empty by day, too wide by night, the galaxies too wild for a girl wrapped in a blanket in a trunk. Back then, she feared the Milky Way's great swirling, but sometimes lately, she hears a voice like her mother's say, to no one in particular, "Oh, stars." Thank you. And if I may, I'd be indulged, I'll read you one from The Half Said Things, my new book. And I'll stick my mail, my website in the chat if anybody's interested in ordering the book. My grandmother's was a Tuam girl named Margaret, Peggy. And when you do research, multiple family members do research, sometimes there are conflicting pieces of information. So this is a little bit of that and a little bit of other things. It's called For the Record. She had a sister named Maggie. How does a Margaret get one of those? And where are the other siblings I've heard existed whose names I don't know? And how did Ballygar get in there in place of Tuam or Slefin? And what did she do with her own girls after Patrick died and she went back to being the maid in other people's houses? All day the rain flies slantwise. The wind drags on the chimney smoke like sailors on their cigarettes after the shelling stops and their ship still floats. All day I've chased the tail of facts that won't add up. Born 1897, maybe 1894, depends on which crystal ball of data you're divining. All day I've felt her glancing around my room, chamois cloth and damp sponge twitching in her fingers at the sight of my dust. I've asked for guidance each time I pass her tucked among the pictures of my sons, first great grands, the ones she forgave me my divorce for. The ones I left the church for, emigrating to the foreign shore of no religion. I pretend it was our common bond, that sailing out towards what it takes, willing to be listed as scrub woman in the 1930 census, or to be known as the one who walked away from the marriage that might kill her. For the record, we each walked up a gangplank and sailed. Thank you.
Wow, Miriam, two powerful poems. They're absolutely beautiful.
Thank you.
So gorgeous. Oh my God, I'm a bit in awe, to be honest. My next reader from the Wexford Bohemian is the lovely Adele Hanley. And I'd like to special congrats to Adele because she submitted her PhD thesis this week. So that's huge. I'll just mute Adele if I can, or maybe you're on mute with Adele. Perfect. Hi, Adele.
Brilliant. So thanks, Alana, for not only including my poem in the Wexford Bohemian, but also for your congratulations. I think for me, this lovely gathering will always kind of coincide now in my memory with the weekend I submitted my thesis. So it's all the more. And lovely to meet everyone else here as well and to hear such wonderful fiction and poetry. So this evening, I want to read my poem from the Wexford Bohemian. And my poem is Valentine. So just bear with me a second. Get organized. Valentine. This year, maybe next, you'll be my Valentine. And I'll wait for you outside the Turkish barbers, deciding on something to say that doesn't make me sound too crazy about you. I'll watch as helium-filled hearts roll down front seat windows of tired pickups, planning their escape in ways much more intelligent than hearts do. And I'll think it's funny how they ascend spring clouds lusting for rain until they catch the eye of some florist clipping thorn from rose, spelling out in earnest what neither of us are brave enough to say. Thank you, short and sweet.
Lovely, Adele, and lovely words at the start. I'm delighted that we coincide with such a gigantic moment of your life. And thank you so much for your submission and congratulations. I've gotten loads of compliments from that story. My next reader from the Wexford Bohemian is Margaret Galvin, an absolutely amazing poet. Margaret, you're unmuted. Perfect.
Yeah.
Hi, Margaret.
Hi, everybody. Good evening. And this is a great tie-up. I hope it'll be the first of many to come between our enterprises. And my poem this evening is a lyrical narrative as well. And it's based on a story that I heard from a house painter who was working in our house recently. And he talked about this woman who frequently rings up his business to ask for people to come and work in her house. And she has no interest in any work being done. She just wants the company. And she feeds whoever comes to the house like a gamecock. Okay. Her boys. The eggs benedict and morning chat usually stretches to elevenses. When she'd pour fresh tea from the china pot into the best cups for her boys, painters and decorators, obliging sorts who'd unblock the sink or change the light bulb, lads with great appetites for her seed cake and Victoria sponge. Lads who become familiar with the life story of every relative whose photograph she draws from the biscuit tin. My mother with the ginnet, Billy who emigrated to Canada, poor Nan let down by the Frenchman. Lads she urged not to strain themselves when they'd insist on rising from the table to shroud her faded furniture with sheets, patch up the walls for a first coat while she busied herself with the washing up, consulted cookery books for recipes for lunch. Those days she powered through supermarket aisles, waved away perfunctory chat about the weather, and she, a woman with no time to dilly-dally, now she had two men to feed, chaps who'd relish her homemade soup, devour her bread. Tousled heads bent over colour charts as the lads, like suitors, offered a playful array of sapphire and gold and ruby before settling for a gentler scheme. It would console her in the months ahead to drink her tea in the primrose kitchen, rustle the newspaper amongst the apricot walls of her front room, wake to the sanctuary of olive and jade. And if some rare caller, the meter reader, or a passing hawker persuaded in for tea, remarked on some particular colour, she'd say with pride and an indulgent smile, "My boys selected that. My boys with the great eye for the colour to suit, a bright tone here and there, a muted shade for calm, turquoise and lavender on the landing to soothe as she braved the stairs to fitful and anxious sleep."
Wonderful.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, wonderful.
Good morning, Margaret. That was beautiful. I'm going to introduce our next reader from the Wax Lemon, and that is Penny Blackburn. Penny has been published in a wide range of magazines and anthologies, and she was recently awarded second prize in the Verb Poetry Competition. She hosts a spoken word night in Time Out, and she is co-host of the Northeast Stanza Group Colour Poets. And we're delighted to have her with us in this edition. So thank you, Penny.
Hi, thank you. Can I just say what a privilege to be here with everybody as part of the festival and as part of the Wax Lemon. So thank you very much for the opportunity for that. I'm going to start with the poem from the Wax Lemon, which is called The Mercury Pool. I can no longer rely on the thinness of water, need to be borne by the cool envelope of mercury, silver shimmer against glazed walls. I push cupped hands against the weight of it, let the beads run over my back, scatter away from my skin and gather at my feet. Heady fumes, an undercurrent of night-scented stock or the musk of old roses, muffled sound against the gleaming surface. Head under, there is only the punch of blood through brain, leaden thoughts transmuted, not to pewter, steel or gunmetal, but to something pure. When I leave, my quicksilver footprints burn neon against the ink blue tiles, an after image visible for one fraction of a moment before the drops roll together, too swift to catch. Thank you. And my second poem from swimming to, I'm picking up on the sea theme here, from swimming to sailing. And this was actually originally inspired by a picture on Twitter. But it sort of ties into that sort of childhood feeling of the sea, sailing. That box was our boat. We sailed it to distant places we had barely heard of, could not have pointed out on any globe or map, argued about the destination, for to children, even imaginary journeys matter. We roved the seas as pirates, as kings or traders, not understanding the link between a man's life and a pineapple. We took turns as captain, took equal shares of any jetsam booty, which we hoarded, buried, refound, cast back. Sometimes one of us would be Jesus with an abbreviated apostle band. We claimed the abandoned scraps of nets, lowered them over the wooden sides to swirl unfilled in barren waters, until we were told to be fishers of men, sent off to spread the gospel to mums and sisters over our supper. But on the day when the women waited, hush-struck, static on the cobble pier, we waited with them until the word came. Then we followed a different box through the lich gate under the U arch to waveless ground. So we left off our box boat voyages, sensing that the tide of play was turning, seeing the faces of our fathers stone blocked as they stooped, scooped a handful of soil before they sailed, an earthy talisman to bring themselves back, salt scarred, to our fragile harbour. Thank you.
Beautiful, Penny. You're clearly very talented. Wonderful words and a wonderful rhythm. Thank you so much. My next reader from the Wexford Bohemian is the great Maybelle Wallace. Maybelle. There you are. Hi, Maybelle.
Hi, thanks, Alana. Thanks for the chance to read, and to Wally from Red Books for all his support for Wexford writers, including myself, because Heart of Cruelty there, my debut novel, won the Meet the Publisher in the 2020 Wexford Literary Festival and was published by Poolbeg as a result of Wally's encouragement of me. And now its sequel, The Piano Player, is coming out in August. So my short fiction, Tinalakan, is in the Bohemian, and it's from two writing prompts in our write club. So one of the prompts was, she found it on the train, and the other one was, duck eggs for sale. Louisa found the advert on the train. It was the daily commute from Clapham Junction to Victoria, and for once there was actually a vacant seat. Stuffed down the side of it was the tractor owner's gazette. It had been well read by someone with black oil on their fingers, but she had nothing else. And as the train kept stopping, she read the small ads. Much of it was for spares, scrappage, servicing, or obscure attachments that carried out unknown agricultural processes. But in the personal column, a small ad caught her eye. Farmer, 40s, scrubs up well, would like to meet half-decent female with GSOH, County Wexford, apply P.O. Box 360, Dublin. She considered the wording, wondering if at 42 it was time to change her lonely existence. A bedsit in the suburbs and a zero-hour job in a call centre was the compass of most of her days. Saturdays, maybe shopping with her mom, once a month, a night out with the girls. There might be more to life than this. A week later, Louisa's hired Ford bumped slowly along a lane where great ovals of tarmac washed away by rain had been crudely patched, giving the road a cobbled effect. She went up and down it twice looking for the house. Brambles struck out at the sides of the car and she was glad she had got the collision damage waiver. On either side was the lush countryside of South Wexford, the trees somehow taller, the colours fresher and brighter than she'd ever seen in England. She pulled up by the only gateway on the lane. All she could see was woodland. Perhaps she'd come to the wrong place despite his detailed directions. The sign on the road said duck eggs for sale, but there was no bell, no entry phone on the old stone gate posts. And when she rang the mobile number, she had no signal. One of the gates was slightly open, or at least jammed in an open position. And that was the correct house name on the gate, Tinalacan. She locked the car. One couldn't be too careful. Then she squeezed through the gap and made her way up the drive, wishing that she had a pair of wellies. Sean's dad had said a farmer in his 40s. She'd concluded that there'd be a farm, a spacious farmhouse of weathered stone with an ager, a pony paddock, an orchard and rolling acres of ripening wheat. But rounding a bend in the overgrown track, tripping over brambles and scratched by gorse, she saw an old static caravan. Green algae coated its windows and net curtains sagged behind them. A clump of ragwork grew out of a drain. On the other side of a yard full of old vans with no wheels and bits of rusting machinery lay a muddy pond and a duck house. A duck started to waddle towards her. No way. She turned to leave. She was going to get back into the hire car, drive back down the rough roads, get on the motorway, go straight back to the airport, back to London. They'd just have to change her flight. But it was too late. Sean must have seen her. The door of the caravan opened. How are you? She thought fast. Could I have half a dozen duck eggs, please? But then her mouth fell open because he was gorgeous, even better than his photo. He went back inside to get the eggs, leaving her with his image burning in her mind. Muscles, tan, blue eyes, tallness, and just the right amount of stubble. €2, please, he said, and holding out the box with a grin. You're Louisa, aren't you? Yes, she said. That's it.
Love that one, Mabel. Congrats on the reading. Anyone that knows Mabel, she's a great friend of mine. She's a very fluid writer. She's able to write in so many genres. It's really admirable. My next reader from the Wexford Bohemian is Caroline Stevens Taylor.
Hi, Alana. Congratulations on this issue. Very well done. Beautiful book. Fantastic contributors. So I'm honoured. And in that vein, the name of my poem is Honour. What burdens takes away your smile or dampens your spirit for a while? What weakness leads your will astray and ponders regret another day? What doubts and fears beguile your thoughts and trespass faith, an outrageous taunt? Let the conscience be weightless and free, honour belief with integrity. That's it, very short and sweet. Thanks very much.
That was beautiful. And Mabel, I was just hanging on that last line also, like everybody else, I think, wanting more. So the next contributor from the Wax Lemon that we're going to hear tonight is Michelle Diaz. Michelle has been published in numerous journals, both online and in print. These include Poetry Wales, Under the Radar, Live Canon, and Prole. She's also appeared in a number of anthologies. Her debut pamphlet, The Dancing Boy, was published in 2019 by Against the Grain Poetry Press. She has just completed her first collection. And the last slide of her bio I'm really curious about. She became the 15th chaired Bard of Glastonbury this year, 2022. I really want to know more about that, Michelle. So thank you for contributing to this edition of Wex Women, Michelle, and we're looking forward to hearing from you.
Just ask Michelle. Yeah, just unmute you there, Michelle. I'll try it once more and see. You should be able to unmute yourself anyway.
Okay, I've done it. Can you hear me? Hi. Oh, thank you so much. It's a real honour to be part of this. And it's lovely to hear so many Irish accents. My dad was a Meath man. And so my first poem is actually sort of linked to him. And it's called, I Felt My Father Die 8 Times. He died on a mad hot summer day as he scarpered from the family. He died with my failed marriage just before the anniversary. He died in Tom, my brother, when underfueled he had a seizure. He died with my dead mother on a threadbare sofa. He died with my surgery and the sepsis that followed. He died in 100 painkillers his first wife swallowed. When he reached his proper death, he did it in style. An explosion in the early hours, a ruptured bowel. It hardly touched my sister, who despised the Irish git. He died in her parting comment. Well, he was always full of shit. I have another one, if that's okay. This has just been published by Cafe Writers on their online forum, and it's called Maddie. We didn't see her for days. The dyed blonde, the girl with a scowl and tattoos, the chain-smoking 20-something, who would sometimes catch sight of you looking at her from an upstairs window, then return your smile with a glare. The girl your son renamed Mardy, the one who slammed the window when you lost it with him in the garden, banged it hard to let you know you were a bad mum who should be social serviced. The one you pondered on over a daily bowl of virtuous muesli, then blamed her for the indigestion. What is her bloody problem? One hard frost morning, she appeared in the garden, in a red spotted onesie, at 10 to 7, fag in hand, phone to her ear, shifty, uneasy, her face not her face, her mouth moving cartoon fast, something come loose in her eyes. We didn't see her for days. Then her mother told us in frightened tones, white as sand, Maddie's lost her mind. She's gone to the hospital. What do you say to something like that? I lit a candle for her this morning to burn away the karma between us. I couldn't help thinking about all the ugly things we place like gargoyles around our heart to keep each other out. Thank you.
Beautiful, Michelle. So full of emotion, so raw. Thank you so much. My next reader from the Wexford Bohemian is Mr. Paul Hennessy. Just unmute you, Paul.
I think I'm unmuted. Yeah.
Yeah, I thought.
Hey, good evening, everyone. Good to be here with all the Bohemians and all the Lemons. And very grateful to both for giving some space to my work. I'm going to read maybe two poems. The first one is the one which was in the Bohemian. And this considers a phenomenon that, you know, happens in Wexford when the opera festival happens, when maybe an opera which has long since been forgotten has been rediscovered. This poem concerns one of those occasions when an opera called Il Piccolo Marat by Mascagni was rediscovered. And the poem conjectures what might have happened if Mascagni came back from the grave and walked around Wexford the next day. Mascagni on Main Street. If he could have walked down Main Street that morning, when all the talk was about the passionate ovation, the powerful Russian bass, Karen Notare's measured coloratura, and how Albert Rosen had commanded the orchestra. He would have been acclaimed from both sides of the street, celebrated on corners, his progress punctuated by handshakes as he went on his way. He would have heard his work analyzed, discussed, and debated, sliced and diced in Doyle's Butchers. If he had stepped into Kelly's bakery for a couple of crusty baguettes, he may even have been applauded before being roundly advised from both sides of the counter as to whether he had been properly served by director, designer, and chorus master. Had he nipped into Simon's for a lunchtime pint, he would have been hailed as the hero of the hour, toasted by the cognoscenti who knew how to appreciate a big sing, and insisted that he was the man to give Donizetti a run for his money. And in the evening, feeling the charm of the old town, he might have ventured from his hotel to watch patrons walking to the theatre, nodding graciously as they passed him by. Enjoying his first outing in this new vernacular, he may even have exchanged pleasantries, knowing his work here was done. Buonasera, signora. Ciao, hon. So, just the second poem, which I'd like to read tonight, is the one which was shortlisted in this year's festival for the Cronin Award, and it seems appropriate to give it a run tonight. This poem just considers how my life was thrown back on occasion to interject with my father's life as an amateur boxer back in the 60s. This is called Taking the Gloves. I had forgotten those nights when you rose in the small hours to listen to title fights on the long wave, drinking coffee in the kitchen and trying not to disturb us as we slept upstairs, the novelty of your ringside report before school the next morning, or how your skipping rope hung in the shed for years to be taken down whenever nostalgia struck and your talk turned to training regimes, bouts and titles, heroes like Floyd Patterson and Sugar Ray Robinson. Today, as we cleared out the attic, I uncovered stacks of your old magazines and scrapbooks, The Ring, Sports Illustrated, boxing, newspaper cuttings patiently saved in old ledgers, and felt again the moment you gave me your gloves, how they hung like dead weights on my limp arms. First signs that I would never find your fighter's edge or instinct, but half a lifetime later, I still hear you. Every time I need to stand my ground or brace myself to take a blow, a whispered gloves up whenever trouble looms. Thank you.
Paul, that's amazing. I hadn't heard that poem yet, and it blew me away. As you can see, another very fluid writer can write on many themes. And congratulations on being shortlisted. Such, like Margaret said on the night, such an amazing achievement. My next reader from the Wexford Bohemian is a great friend of mine, Anne Ireton.
Hi, hello. Congratulations, Alana, on the publication, Wexford Bohemian, and congratulations to the Wax Lemon on their launch as well. I'm absolutely honoured to be here. The poem is called Utopia of Her Imagination. A world of candles burning and incense curling, stars in a constellation and flowers blooming. She dreams in smells and sights and sounds in a world removed from this, where she walks barefoot amongst copper and plum coloured leaves, crackling under her feet as she sweeps through small gatherings of timeless trees with grace and poise, immune to hatred, jealousy and bile, immune to financial burden. She's in a world where money has no meaning. She imagines a world warm sand stretches before her with no view of a horizon, a limitless, vast sense of pure wild freedom, untamed by the confines of concrete buildings and high-rise apartments. Beyond the mounds of desert, she sees a splendid ocean, deeper than her mind will dare allow her to travel, where psychedelic fish, magnificent whales and orcas, mackerels and seahorses bask in their own eternity of their glorious habitats, devoid of murderous plastic traps, devoid of COVID masks, luring them to early graves in brutal factories and metal tins and salivating human tongues. She stops in her track, transfixed at the vision of mystic clouds descending overseas in front of her, thrilling her to the bone, as surreal otherworldly images of shapes and dimensions, of floating fluffy entities invoke heavenly awe. Kaleidoscopic iridescent rainbows of myriads of colours of vibrant sunlight radiate through the clouds in sublime splendour. Nothing and no one can take this sight away from her memory. Embodied, entrenched like a divine cosmic spirit inside her, as the red sunset silent and slow descends into a deep, vast horizon and hides from view, an immense loss. The ending of a day and the beginning of something new. In the darkness beyond the parameters of mere eyesight, she senses the olfactory bliss of bluebells and white garlic melt. It wafts with innocence in the atmosphere, as if unaware of their perfume enveloping in the soundless, invisible air, as still as the darkness of night. Impenetrable velvet mystery surrounds her as she glances upwards at the boundless, immeasurable sky, spreading into the mind-blowing infinity of space, where galaxies and constellations of stars, solar systems and planets exist beyond the limits of human comprehension. Yet there are worlds within the universe where Earth is like a grain of sand or speck of dust, yet with an existential right to be, just as she or anyone else in the cosmos has. A homeless woman with a couple of children outside a train station, covered in a worn blanket with a coffee cup and a few coppers, emerges in the forefront of her mind, as does the President of America, the owner of Amazon, and the lightweight world boxing champion. A bumblebee floats around her ear, buzzing like a symphony of nature, an image of a cow calving and an old man fading into the oblivion of death, emaciated by life, ready to be transported to the next world, wherever, whatever, and however that goes. She wonders fleetingly, but decides in her mere human mind, it's a question she cannot ever comprehend or know the answer to, except for her faith in her belief that there is a creator. The hallelujah chorus explodes in her ears like an auditory hallucinogen, sending her into a state of euphoria. She basks transcendent in the resplendent sounds, haunting the world. Her utopian dream is manifested by magnificent aspects of reality, where corruption, strife, hurt and pain, hate, envy, disdain, murder, rape, theft, one-upmanship, abuse, neglect, where rubbish dumps, pollution, internet, bills, poverty, hunger, destitution, prostitution, where conflict, war and religion that divide, cults that brainwash and misguide and headfuck and deprive, mass media that destroys originality, where eyes are always on the prize and the trophies of life are to undermine, derise and divide mankind. Enough, enough, enough. A utopian world is inside her mind, her imagination. By being strong and gentle and kind, she can live and rise and thrive in the wonder of each moment. Feeling, healing, seeing, believing, being. Sensing her universe, a speck of dust in the great scheme of things. She walks on. Thank you.
Okay, back to me, and it is my pleasure now to introduce my co-editor of the Wax Lemon, Joanne McCarthy.
I'm ready. Joanne writes. Just to see if I'll will let me speak.
Joanne writes in both English and Irish. Her work has been published in Poetry Ireland Review, The Stinging Fly, The Honest Ulsterman, Irish Independent New Irish Writing, Splunk, and many more. She is the co-editor of the literary journal The Wax Lemon, and she is currently reading poetry at the Seamus Heaney Centre, Queen's University, Belfast.
Thanks, Derek, and thank you, Alana, for the invitation to contribute. And thank you to all the contributors that we've heard so far. It's just been, it's great. We get so many submissions and we read and we have external readers and we come together and we roundhouse and we discuss. And it's funny how much more the voice of the poet can bring to your encountering of a poem. So thank you so much to all the contributors. We were blown away by the level of submissions that we got, standard submissions that we got for the Wax Lemon for this edition. So yeah, I'm going to read an Irish language poem of mine. And
hello.
Hello. okay, I might just continue. This references the Chicxulub Impactor, the crater that's in New Mexico where the Chicxulub Impactor landed. It's the thing that where the dinosaurs referenced that. And it's in Irish, but I think I'll read the English language translation first. And the English language translation is called Safe Landing. Safe Landing. Crocodiles lay eggs, eggs, the youngest lad cries. His eyebrows raised so high, I can't say a word about the origin of Steggy, the dinosaur who grows all day long in the toy room. Nor can I tell that the moon is no lone wolf. She has kin all over the galaxy, constellation cousins and meteorite sisters. Because how could I speak about the Chicxulub Impactor, that black sheep that murdered Steady's kind? How do they come out of the eggs, man? With sharp little teeth, I answer. And someday we'll go to Mexico. There's a hole in the ground waiting for you. agus an don chap son. Baron Criggle, Ivica, Ivica, a scarp na machanage zoiga, a valley co ortaha, knock fader lum fuckle rodo, fi steggy on dinosaur, a gion all good joes of us can break on. No, and slee nach mach tira inerchi and gelach. Gwilja furki ar fud na real tree, cull kakarka na real vwinta, cull shesherka in a dre gita. Conisk in show do fwin shikslub and pactor, and kalinak shin ar varig winter stegi ilik. Conisk in avanchi saan asam leis gavam. Le fiacla biog a gira ar agriu. Agus, raya mid log a Mexico, top howls a talavan.
Cahin a has wanted. Grandmother, Grandmother,
thank you.
The creches of Dara Changa, Gunamil Margaret. I was on Dalek. Hugh Doyle, the fantastic Hugh Doyle, is my last reader from Wexford Bohemian. Hugh, you're unmuted. Hi, Hugh.
Yeah, unmuted. Can everybody hear me? Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah, I'd like to read you two poems. First one is the poem that's in the issue 3 of the Wexford Bohemian, which is called The Rising Sun. The Rising Sun was a fishing boat that sank off the coast of Wexford about 15 years ago now, with the loss of one of the men on the boat. The Rising Sun. Embarking Duncannon before dawn, tinning trails of white twine swashing in briny blue. November's burning horizon, golden leviathan rises. The rising sun caught no reflection, too heavy, too unstable. 3 men hauling trains of crab pots suddenly sinking. The skipper, Pat, plunging into an escapeless embrace. Jimmy and Ian cast overboard, clinging like limpets to an upturned keel. They're breathing and bobbing and breathing unisoned, singing songs, sea-slapped boat clapping along. The communities of Slade, Kilmore and Ballyhack, shoaling quayside, thinning fingertips on the salt these rocks descend, all light now sunk. Lost, taken down to journey depths we will never see. Missing skin still felt, invisible fingers tracing cheeks, a wife, a child wiping tears. Those stolen cannot come home, held in netted despair, cannot mourn. Knotted in a chair below a window beyond which resides the sea. A glass-trapped sun neither rises nor sets, some apposite snow globe where nothing ever settles. Tears will bring no comfort with their ebbing tides of salt, only a body returned, washed of hurt. Thank you. The second piece I'd like to read is been taken by Nawr magazine, Welsh magazine. And it's on the subject of memory. It's about the bogs. I lived in Spittle in County Galway for a number of years. I lived on the edge of a bog. It's called Turbury's Tithe. And Turbury refers to an ancient rite to dig, cut and carry away turf on bog located on another person's land for you to use as fuel in your own home. So Turbury's Tithes. Structured over slow distilling time, bottled memories broken over brows of brown-bellied hills torn open, sodden temples of past erected by hands, time's threaded bones replicating fathers, centrally placed burial mounds, Axis Mundi binding digger and dug, offering back from oil black earth that which was laid as gift or store for harder days, lost to fragile landscapes for the difficulty of memory. Here sea urchin spiked grasses finger tidal winds, blackening inks of deep sea seep staining crusted clumps of singed scrub, all life mirroring itself, refracting in smoky seaweed sods, licking ancient hands. Horizons cold, milking, curdling, elements of the said, unsaid, the lost and the found, the living and the dead. Thank you very much.
Beautiful, Hugh. Thank you so much. He was incredibly talented. I just pasted his Facebook page for his poetry into the chat there if anyone would like to check that out. And of course, he travelled from Wales to Wexford for our book launch, which I think was just shows how much of a passionate reader and writer he is. So that's the end of our contributors' readings, which were, I think we'll all agree, exceptional. So we're going to open up a bit of an open mic. Our first reader to go onto the stage was Claire. Claire, would you like to read aloud a piece?
Yeah, I would. Thank you for doing the open mic. Haven't done one of these in quite a while because after COVID there wasn't many online. So it's good to be back doing them. The piece I'm going to be reading is called Empty. She sits there on her secondhand sofa, rubbing her stomach, the baby inside. And they listen to the symphony, the harmonies of urban poverty, two men shouting in the flat overhead, and the sirens that pass by. Their blue lights flashing through the window, shining against an empty bottle of rum, one that sits on the countertop and has sat there for 8 months now. She is clean now. It was a struggle, the fight of her life, the life she didn't care about, not until she saw those two lines, a reason. She felt that first kick, and there in that moment, there was nothing left to fill. There was no more emptiness, no void left to fill with cheap liquor and beer. Today, she bought some roses. To fill that empty bottle, she bought a crib too, saved up for weeks. She was ready. Ready just in time, she looked around, pride welling up inside. She'd done it. Somewhere, someone must have been looking down, because she had no idea how. She had put back all the pieces when a year ago they were nowhere to be found. She feels a pain in her stomach worse than anything she's felt before, and she is smiling. Because her baby is on his way, she thinks. The ambulance picks her up and she is smiling. They pull up to the hospital, take her into room, place her on a bed, and she is smiling. A midwife comes in, and it takes a while. The sun starts to rise as her baby boy is born. She closes her eyes and waits for a cry. The midwife holds the baby tight, and she waits for a cry. The midwife has panic in her eyes, and she waits for a cry. The midwife looks for a pulse, and she waits for a cry. She waits for a cry. The only tears are her own. The baby is still silent. The baby is still. Tears stain her fake as if anyone, anywhere was looking down. They are crueler than fiction, more evil than the sinners they forbid. And she sits there on her secondhand sofa, empty again. She sees the roses, the bottle of rum, walks to the door, grabs her purse, her keys. The bottle of rum smashes it against the wall. The roses scatter along the kitchen floor. She's back by one. Empty bottle in hand, been empty since 12:30. Stumbles to the sofa, doesn't get that far. Lays next to the roses, the sirens, their blue light flashing against her skin, her tear-stained skin. She opens another bottle. She'll sell the crib tomorrow, then go to the off-license or maybe the pub. Somewhere, anything, where she can buy something, anything, to feel something, anything, other than empty. Thank you.
Well done, Claire. That was exceptional. Oh my God, very saddening. So beautiful. And fair play to you for reading such a powerful story. Beautiful reading. Our next reader is Jerry Roach.
I have two poems. One's a quiet poem. I find it a bit unusual for me to be doing poetry because I'm writing and I've written one novel and I'm on to my second. But I find sometimes my characters burst into verse. So I go for poetry or the long, really long novel, and I seem to have hand in both. And also I'm interested in romance, humor, spirituality. So I think I'm going, part of me feels I'm going against the grain. So I've been very hesitant about bringing out anything. So it just happened that I sent one poem to my friend Declan Sinnott, and they liked it so much, he and his partner did a musical version of it, which gave me the courage to actually say, okay, I can do these things. So the first one is a quiet one, and it's about a place I never thought I would go to, but I'd always had this romance of going to, and it's called Bellagio, Lake Como. Mm. It's like a dream, I said, gazing across the cobalt lake to grey green ridges of the mountain rising up, to crimson bougainvillea flashing flamingo walls of villas strutting the water's edge. It's like a dream, I said, at the French windows of our room, spellbound. And you come and wrap your arms around me, your chin on my shoulder, sharing the view. In the warmth of the summer evening, we walk along the quayside beneath the white canopy of oleander trees, confetti sweeping our feet. A flash catches my eye and I stop, transfixed. Shimmering, pellucid pools in swaying water. Light becomes water, water, light, liquid, light, mind, all one. A Saturi moment. I shift my gaze and watch you strolling with soft steps towards the Lido. It's like a dream, I said. And you come and wrap your arms around me, gathering me in. It's more than I ever could have imagined. This beauty, this moment, your love. That's that one. And thank you. And I have a different one, which is a response to an event I attended, and I have to confess I'm a child of the 60s, 70s. I'm from Wexford, but I left after secondary school, and I'd also had lived in England before, so I'm a mixture. Anyway, this is a response to an event. It's called The Warp. Pall Mall is desolate, dark, dead. The air itself is frozen with a bitter, gelid cold that chills to the bone. New Year's Eve, far away from home. But here, a light, an open door, welcoming, well, come on in. Inside, a carnival of color and movement in yellow, orange, gold, a medieval fair, a stall with treats to behold, a maiden, a jester, a juggler leading us in song to a small theater for the show, a comedy of innocence in pop-up scenes on podiums to enrapture those with nowhere to go. A homeless family find a giant shelter in a haystack, a Bethlehem of their own, with rooms like any home. A young man they meet on the road, hungry, lost, presented with a full British on a plate, becomes a 3D painting of wonder and delight in his psychedelic state. A wave of laughter fills the packed hall. This comedy of innocence has us all in thrall. Outside the mall, a crystal carpet under snow. Out of the black appears a carriage all aglow, in Cinderella colours of white and gold, drawn by six white steeds, their braying snorts belching puffs of dragon smoke. A livery man in Sergeant Pepper costume descends and opens the door. We climb in and are carried home on a cloud of magic inside a poem. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity. Okay, thanks very much.
Beautiful, Jerry. Thank you so much. Lovely, absolutely lovely. Our next open mic reader is Alice. Hi, Alice.
Hi, how are you? Can you hear me? One second. Thank you. So I'm new to writing, so it's a bit of a lockdown discovery. So thanks for the opportunity, and I've enjoyed all the reading. Sometimes we have lots of obstacles in life, and sometimes we have to clear the ground to find our way. So my first poem is called Clearing the Ground. I spent the evening gardening my soul. I scanned the tattered landscape, the shattered pieces of my life, my heart. I gathered up the hurt and weeded false beliefs. It's time to dig a new drill of hope and sow the seeds of my future. And I have a second poem, if that's okay as well. And I like gardening. It kind of gives me some sense of, I suppose, relaxation, even though it's hard work. And I like spending the evening time in the garden when the weather is good. And this is called The Night Beckons. A leafy silhouetted gap in the treescape frames my view. It is a window through the landscape of my soul. I am humbled by its simple beauty. Nighttime and the earth sleeps. Breathe life and growth through all that allow it. Soothing, anchoring, and expanding us from within. In its stillness, I feel peaceful. I glance right. My illuminated path twinkles like the stars. Steeped in art's mystery, I must await its secrets, for they will yield in time. Now I invite the earth inwards, breathing in ease to match the rhythm of my being. Mine is a gentle path forwards. Thank you.
That's beautiful, Alice. Thank you so much for joining. I'm delighted you enjoyed the evening. You would not think that you are new to writing at all. That's some beautiful language in there. Sounds like took years to develop. And our final reader for the open mic is Mary Howlett. Hiya, Mary.
Hi, how are you? I'm new to writing as well, like Alice. I've only recently joined a creative writing group, and I'm really enjoying it. And I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to come on to the open mic tonight. My poem is called My Mother's Hands, and I was inspired to write this. My mother is in a nursing home, and when I go to visit her, I always put cream on her hands, and she seems to enjoy that. So My Mother's Hands. They only knew to wash, brush, sew, make do. Never felt the pleasure of soft cream, red nail varnish. Ragged cuticles weeded, turned collars, yet her hands were gentle, gathered wild flowers from May altars. Nimble fingers guided the singer, dreams entwined in the fabric. Soapy hands danced to the rhythm of the scrubbing board. Her short auburn curls damp from the sweat. Her wedding ring worn only on Sundays. Blue veins pulsed to the rhythm of her prayers. Mysteries of the rosary beads counted the decades of her life. Thank you.
Beautiful, Mary. Once again, some fantastic, fantastic writing for someone who's only new to writing. And such a lovely story as well. I'm now going to invite my fellow committee member from Wexford Literary Festival, Anne Gilpin, to say a few words about the festival and our surprise announcement that we announced on the award ceremony on Friday.
Thanks very much, Alana. I'd like to actually say to Claire, thank you for reminding us the importance of having Zoom events. At one stage, it was like, oh, Zoom or over Zoom. But this festival this year, because we're kind of like back into doing physical things, it's also reminded us that these Zoom events are community events, and to be able to come together with like-minded people and to hear stories internationally, it's like, no, we're not over Zoom events. And I just really want to thank Wexford Bohemian and for the Wax Lemon for putting this on tonight. Margaret Galvin and I, for the last 2 years, did it for the shortlisted poets for our Anthony Cronin Short Poem Award. And I would encourage you as poets to enter the competition. However, equally, you are published. So I'm going to be encouraging all the people in the past who have both done stories and poetry to send off to the Waxed Lemon and to Wexford Bohemian, because it's just a wonderful way of you being recognised for the work you've done. And in saying that, we are just thrilled that the Wexford Bohemian have agreed that in the next issue, they're going to publish the award-winning poem by Angela Patton, who lives in Vermont, USA. Her poem's called Shine. I was nearly going to rush off and get it and read it, and I thought, no, I can't do that. It's going to be published. I'll leave it to you to read, to see why Margaret Galvin, who you heard tonight, who's our judge, selected that as the top poem. And also a great story, The Witch by David Butler from Bray, and that's going to be published. He's the winner of the Colm Devine Short Story Award in the next edition of Wexford Bohemian, which will be when, Alana?
We're hoping submissions will be open in September and it'll be out for late October, early November.
Brilliant, and well done. So thank you for all, and for me to be able to listen to all the contributions. It's just wonderful to celebrate with you all and to listen to such beautiful voices. All unique, all powerful. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Anne. We just have one more reader who unfortunately came in late, but I'm delighted they're here. Someone that I'm very proud of and that has to read, whether they like it or not, I insist. Everyone, this is Erin Equalon. She's our youngest contributor at 16 years of age, and she's incredible. Hi, Erin.
Hello. Hello, everyone. Thank you. I'll share a poem called The Woman in the Rushes. The Woman in the Rushes. Green silence glistens and spreads across land of drowsy, chilly skin. Textile of blooming laid down by ancient hand. We watch her cowering in the rushes. With rising life, her eyes give birth to existence, to entity, to creature. Florets drawn up, placed on the grave of winter. We watch her, cowering in the rushes. One final time, she wraps hand round branch. With slow love, advancing is the floret. And as tradition moves through our body, we watch the woman in the rushes. Thank you.
Beautiful, Eric and Margaret, and it was lovely to hear everybody at the open mic there and to hear new voices and some voices I recognised, Claire, and lovely to hear Watford poet Mary Hallett, who is just shooting up or is in her poetry writing this year, and I can't wait to hear more from her. Thank you all. I'm going to introduce Derek. Apologies for not introducing him earlier, and he's going to sing us out, I believe. Derek Flynn is an Irish author, playwright and musician with a master's in creative writing from Trinity College Dublin. He is the author of 7 novels, no less, including the Detective John Ryan series featuring the eponymous ex-cop turned private detective. His award-nominated plays have been performed in various venues throughout Ireland, including the prestigious Seen and Heard Festival in Smock Alley, Dublin, and Derek co-edits The Wax Women with myself for his sins. So thank you very much, Lana. Thank you to Red Books, to Wexford Literary Festival, to Larry, to everybody who organised the event. It was great. And thank you most, especially, to all the readers here tonight and the contributors. You are.
Okay, thank you all so much. I'll just echo what Anne said there about the Zoom. I was just thinking the same thing myself earlier on. Everyone says, oh, we're sick of these Zoom things. And while in-person open mics and performances and stuff are fantastic, it's also great for not just for myself, Joanne, and obviously Alana, to be able to see and hear the poets that we published who are abroad or wherever that we wouldn't normally be able to get at these events, but also for everybody to just be able to connect at these kind of events wherever they are in the world. So yeah, absolutely. I hear from me as far as Zoom events definitely not being over, I think. An event like this with the Wexford Bohemian, hopefully the Wax Lemon and the Wexford Bohemian will be able to do this again at some stage in the future, because it was a wonderful night. So thanks, Alana. Thanks, Anne. Thanks, everybody, for reading. I'm going to play out with a little bit of Paul Simon.
So on this great and joyful day, but the mother-child reunion is only a motion away. Oh, little darling of mine, can't for the life of me imagine a sadder day. No, they say let it be, but it never turns out that way. Course of a lifetime runs over and over again. Well, I would not give you false hope on this strange and mournful day, but the mother and child reunion is only a motion away. Can't believe it's so. No, they still have a way. I've never been laid so low in such a mysterious way. Course of a lifetime runs over and over again. Well, I would not give you my soul. Child reunion is only a motion away. The mother and child reunion is only a motion away. And the mother and child reunion is only a motion away. Away, and the mother connection reunion, so emotional way. Thanks a lot. Good night, folks.
Thank you, everyone, so much.
Bye-bye.
Fabulous. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Night. 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 Okay.